In the video today, we're answering a viewer question because Luke Ziller asks us, what causes aftertaste? There are a surprising number of things that go into taste, like smell, temperature, texture, taste perceived by taste buds, and even your general perception of the thing that you are eating. Like if someone blindfolds you and tells you you're about to drink root beer, then gives you Sprite, don't be surprised if you think it's root beer, or perhaps just a slightly off-tasting root beer. Our brains are very weird things. As for that flavor, there are five basic flavors that our taste buds perceive. They are sweet, salt, sour, bitter, and umami. And before we go any further, we feel obliged to point out that the idea that we have a taste map on our tongues, where specific zones are responsible for specific flavors or perceive specific flavors more strongly, is false. In any event, taste buds are a grouping together of around 50 to 150 flavor cells, known as gustatory cells. These buds are dispersed throughout the tongue in three different types of structures called papillae. The three papillae types are fungiform, foliate, and circumvallate. Your gustatory cells contain within them hairs that have proteins on them. Those proteins react to the chemicals in our food and drink to bind them to the cell. These cells have neuron-like properties, namely depolarization, that can cause the release of neurotransmitters. It's these neurotransmitters that are perceived by the brain as flavor. About half the flavor cells within each taste bud react to several of the five basic flavors. These reactions vary in sensitivity to each of the five types. A specific cell might react strongly to sweet, but poorly to salt. The next cell to it might react strongly to salt and poorly to sweet. Those reactions are classified in levels of intensity from 1 to 10. The other half of flavor cells within a taste bud are specialized and react to only one flavor. When you combine these flavors and variants of intensity of flavor between taste buds with how the food or drink smells, feels, its temperature, and your overall perception, there are countless different tastes that can be perceived by our brains. For example, the smell of food affects its taste, even potentially perceiving things the taste buds can't, as our olfactory senses can't perceive significantly more odors than our taste buds can flavor. Fruity, nutty, garlic, and burnt, to name a few. This is why, when your nose is stuffed up, foods taste a little differently than when it's not. This finally brings us to aftertaste. As you might be guessing at this point, after the explanation of how flavor works, aftertaste is thought to be remaining chemicals from food or drink still affecting the gustatory cells on the tongue, at the back of the throat, on the epiglottis, and at the upper part of your esophagus, when all the other factors of overall taste, like smell and texture, are no longer affecting the brain. In some sense, this is the real taste of the thing that you're consuming. And now for a bonus fact. Speaking of weirdness with flavors, it turns out there is a fruit that turns sour things to sweet. The plant that produces the berries, Cincipalum dulcificum, is native to West Africa, where the fruit was traditionally used to sweeten palm wine and make soured cornbread more palatable. Growing best in acidic soil in tropical zones, the coffee-sized berries were introduced to Europeans by the explorer Chevalier de Marchais. So, how does it work? The exact mechanisms here aren't fully understood, but in a nutshell, the fruit gets its sweetening properties from miraculin, a glycoprotein in the berry that binds to sweet receptors on the tongue. As to how the miraculin then makes sour things taste sweet, it appears to relate to the pH of miraculin, which is neutral, and sour foods, which are acidic. More specifically, when the miraculin binds to the sweet receptors in the tongue, it is mostly inert until it comes into contact with acidic substances. When that happens, the miraculin changes structure slightly, with the result being the sweet receptors it is bound to becoming activated. Because miraculin binds so strongly to the sweet receptors on the tongue, the berry does not have to be eaten with the sour food, and the sweetening effect may last as much as 30 to 60 minutes after chewing the berries. The duration of the effect depends on flavors, including the concentration of the miraculin, how long it was in contact with the tongue, and the concentration of the acid in the otherwise sour food. Not a subtle effect, the perceived sweetness produced by the miracle fruit can be remarkable, equivalent to up to a 17% sucrose solution. For reference here, the equivalent sucrose solution for typical soft drinks is only about 10%. The effect is things like Tabasco sauce reportedly changing flavor to that of a donut glaze, among a myriad of other weird taste alterations. So I really hope you found that video interesting. If you did, please do hit that thumbs up button below, and don't forget to subscribe. We got brand new videos just like this every day of the week. For more from me, why not check out a podcast I do called The Brain Food Show. If you search brain food, one word, wherever you get your podcasts, you will find it. It's sort of facts, but a bit more freeform. I really think you'll enjoy it if you enjoyed this show. And as always, thank you for watching.